Good morning this day, and welcome in the name of our Lord Christ. Welcome to this service of worship. It's good to see you. Good to feel the blessing of being together. I wish the pews were as crowded as the aisle. Today is a grand day, and we give thanks for the opportunity it gives us to worship God. Let me remind you of the attendance registers on the inside aisle end of the pew. We're asking everybody, if you will, to give us your name and address and email and everything else you can think of, even longtime members, because we are revising our church directory, and we have some incorrect information. For instance, a lot of people have given up their home phone and just have a cell phone, and so we need to know that sort of stuff. So thanks, if you would, just give us your information as those pads are passed. And of course, that's also a way for those who are visiting with us to give us your information so we can follow up on getting to know you better, which of course we want to do. Immediately following the service today, we're having two celebrations combined. One is the annual celebration of Seersucker Sunday on the Sunday before Labor Day weekend. We always ask people if they want to wear seersucker at the end of the summer season. And we will try to take a picture of everybody who is so attired in the fellowship hall following the service today. But perhaps even more important than Seersucker Sunday, if that's possible, is we're also using this as a way of bidding a very fond farewell to our friend and colleague, David Muffet. David is going to be the youth director at the Trinity Presbyterian Church in Little Rock, Arkansas. And they're, of course, very lucky to have him over the years. And it has been 8 years that David has been in this position. Of course, he is also a child of this church, if you will. We helped to make and form him, and so we're grateful that he's carrying that with him as he goes. We'll miss him, of course. He's been a wonderful addition to our church and to our staff, and has really, really been important in the lives of so many young people. We may not realize how important that really is, that young people have somebody that they can talk to in confidence, someone who they know cares about them, somebody who's there for them, no matter what. And David has certainly been that person for our youth, and we will miss him as he goes on his way. Well, enough of the syrupy and sappy. We'll have more of that in the fellowship hall after the worship today. God calls us, invites us, that we would come to be a part of worship. And we come not because we are noble and great or wonderful, but rather because we hope that in the presence of God we might find ourselves renewed and repaired and restored to all that God desires for us. And so as we come needy, but also glad, let us come to worship God. Amen. Thank you. And let us rise in spirit and in body and be called to worship using the opening sentences. The Lord sets the prisoner free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord watches over the stranger. Put not your trust in princes in whom there is no help.
Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and everyone who humbles himself will be exalted. Humbly, let us approach God, confessing our sin, using the prayer printed in the order of worship. Holy God, even when you call us to be humble, we are driven to flatter ourselves and to seek pleasure and reward. We are more determined to gain advantage than we are to do service. You see us seeking gain, even when such gain is at another's expense. Forgive us, we pray, for lack of humility. Help us to rediscover the benefits of giving and sharing. Let us rediscover the great kingdom values of Jesus Christ, our Lord, whose giving knows no end. Amen.
For it is in the strong name of our Lord Christ that we pray. Amen. In our scripture reading, we will hear a parable from Jesus where the lesser invitee to a party is given the higher place. And so it is for all of us that though we may be soiled with the sins of a lifetime, our Lord invites us to come up and to join him and to be glad. Friends, again this day, hear and believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven. Amen. And so with great thanksgiving and as forgiven and redeemed people, let us greet one another with a word of peace. Indeed, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you. Let us pray for illumination. O Lord, whose love is infinite and whose justice is swift, open to us the mysteries of your word. Let us receive what we hear today gratefully and hopefully, securing us in the assurance of life in Christ, triumphing over sin and death. In the name of Christ, amen. The psaltery reading today is from Psalm 146, a hymn praising God for help. Praise the Lord, O my soul. While I have any being, put not your trust in princes, for when their breath goes from them, they return again to the earth. Blessed is the man whose help is the God of Jacob, the God who made heaven and earth, who keeps faith forever. The Lord gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord loves the righteous. He upholds the widow and the fatherless. The Lord shall be king forever.
Talk about the room being filled with music. How lovely that is. One of the good ideas we've had recently around here is the development of what we're hoping to call a physical choir. Of course, the choir we've got is pretty physical, but we're thinking of folks who will not necessarily sing, but will enhance our worship in another way. And so today our physical choir is going to help us with a presentation of the gospel reading. It comes from Luke, the 14th chapter, and selected verses from that chapter. And I'll ask you all to stand and ask our physical choir, if you will, come forward. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you're invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down in the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you are has been invited by your host, and the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place. And then, in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you're invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher, and you'll be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He also said to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your neighbors or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. And this is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. We should say a special word of thanks to Mallory Hudson. I'm not sure if that was her directorial debut, but it was her directorial debut with us. Thank you very much, Mallory, for helping all of us get together. Well, the gospel reading we just saw and heard says it pretty plainly, doesn't it? Jesus is on his way to the cross, and he wants us to hear him on this particular subject, the subject of putting other people first. Jesus wants us to be ready, because soon enough, God does intend to exalt the righteous and the just, those who have been the most generous and humble. So, just for a moment, imagine yourself at a big, lavish party. Handsome men and elegant women are swirling around in this large ballroom. And in the center of the room, there is a striking ice sculpture. It's a sculpture of a large bird, a bird piercing her own breast with her beak, wounding herself for the sake of her chicks in the nest. And inside that glistening ice sculpture, the artist has placed a single scarlet lily. And the lily seems to be both the beating heart of the bird and also the bloody place where she has wounded herself in order that she might feed her children. And the guests continue to arrive at the party, and everything seems to be just right. The guest list, after all, includes all the very best people, and the revelers throw their heads back, and they laugh, and it's the laughter of delight, and nothing at all could spoil the magnificence of this most perfect celebration. The shadows that strike the ice-sculpted bird now draw our attention to some other guests who have just entered the party. These people aren't smiling, and they're not swirling around. They're lined up sort of wallflower style around the room. Some of them look tired. Some of them are sitting down. These new guests, they don't all have clean faces. Some of them have worn clothes. Some of them even look angry. It would seem, at first, that these new guests don't belong at the party, but they do belong. Some of them are even holding their invitations. But none of them are trying to come to the center of the room, where all the beautiful people are gathered. The elegant people at a party, of course, we all know this, like to exchange wise remarks. They like to make themselves sound clever. And so someone says expansively, I've always thought the moral test of a society is how it treats its children and the elderly and those who are in the shadows of life, the sick, the needy, and the handicapped. In response, someone else lifts their glass in a toast and nods appreciatively and says, yes, to quote Mahatma Gandhi, a nation's greatness is measured in the way it treats its weakest members. Well, by now the ice sculpture is beginning to melt. The scarlet lily in the breast of the bird begins to be exposed. And the effect of this is amazing. It seems as if the heart of the bird is beating ever more rapidly. And it also seems that the pelican really is doing herself harm, tearing into her own body in order to feed her offspring. The pelican in her piety was a medieval symbol for Jesus Christ. The bird, it is said, although this is not really true, but in observation it seemed that the bird would bleed for her nestlings, just as Jesus gave himself for the world by his crucifixion. We've been reading from the Gospel of Luke for several weeks now, and we've noted that in that Gospel, ever since Luke chapter 9, in verse 51, ever since then, we've seen that a hinge in the Gospel has opened up. That verse says, and when the time came for Jesus to be offered up, Jesus set his face to go to Jerusalem. We see that in Luke's Gospel, everything that happens after that verse pertains to Jesus and the cross. And so, Jesus' lesson to us today about humility and about putting others first in our lives has the critical perspective of his upcoming death. When Jesus says, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and everyone who humbles himself will be exalted, we do see that cross looming in the distance. Jesus has a great personal sacrifice and a deep self-giving love on his mind. This is Jesus' way. And we who follow Jesus confess we do not always understand it easily. The ice sculpture reflects the light in such a way that the poor, ragged people in the room are surprisingly illuminated. We can't neglect the bright, beautiful people who are swirling in our midst in the ballroom, but suddenly it seems that the ragged people are important too. The light shines. The pelican in her piety is showing us the ragged people. She's showing them off as if they are the ones who mattered the most. And Jesus, in his piety, is the life of the world, the whole world. And by his love, the whole world is being saved. Any of us who have ever cared for someone else will, I hope, find ourselves engaged right here in this verse. Mothers and fathers who have cared so deeply for their children. Mothers and fathers who would gladly give or give up anything in order to ease their child's way in the world. Teachers who take a great interest in their students' lives and know that sometimes those lives are difficult. Volunteers in our church's many programs of care for the needy, and especially those who are aware of the special hurt that those needy people feel. They hurt in a particular way. They especially feel a kind of loneliness. It is the loneliness of feeling deprived in this land of plenty. And if we're honest, we'll admit that we too can sometimes feel worn and worn out. We are more like the ragged people than we would normally admit, because we too have occasionally been left out here and there. Or we've had to endure insults and still force a smile at times. Or we've gotten bad news, or we've been the messenger of bad news, or we've struggled with our health, we've suffered disappointments. All of this goes together, doesn't it? It goes together to make a life. And because life has some difficulties in it, we say, That's just the way it goes. That's the way the cookie crumbles. But still, it isn't quite fair, is it? And the difficulties of life make us feel isolated and alone. In the center of the room and in the center of their hearts, the people coming to this party find a symbol of love that gives of itself to the beloved. We ourselves as Christians are drawn to Jesus Christ because we are ourselves a little worn and weary. And Jesus gives himself up for all of us. In 1969, when the astronauts Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong walked on the surface of the moon, there was a little girl who grew up to be a Presbyterian minister who was very, very sick, and she needed surgery. The little girl was just 9 in 1969, and she watched the moon landing from her hospital bed. Her surgery was the next day, and when that day rolled around, she cried a little bit. She hadn't cried before about her illness, but she cried on the morning of her surgery. She said that she just wanted someone, or doctor, or someone else. She just wanted someone to say that it was going to be okay. But for some reason, on that day, nobody said that. Nobody said what she most needed to hear. And that's why I am a Presbyterian minister, she told me one time. I want to be able to tell people that it's okay. It's okay to be scared because there's always someone with you. Jesus' love is good news, she says. We should all be as happy as those men jumping for joy on the moon. Well, I love that story. I love what it says about the power of our compassion and also about our human need for compassion, our need for someone who shows us that they care. I love it that the little girl thought the astronauts were jumping for joy. When you're invited to the feast, says the Lord, go and sit at the lowest place, the least place, the place without honor, the place where human hurt and human fear are most real. Go and sit at the lowest place so that when the host comes, who is surely Jesus, when the host comes, he'll invite you to go up higher. That's the way of Jesus Christ. It's also the way of Christ's church. We save a spot at the head of the table for people whose hurts are real. We say it's okay because there's always someone with you, and you can be as happy as the men jumping for joy on the moon. It is a great party with all the beautiful people at their best. Hooray for beautiful people. But it's even better because Jesus tells us to remember to invite the poor, the lame, the maimed, and the blind. And it's a great party because we can see ourselves reflected in Christ. We can see ourselves in the one who gave himself for us, the one whose agony has brought the world its healing. I hope that as we continue to try to follow in Jesus' way, that we will want to pray for someone that we think is broken. Consider that person now. And we will want to put our arm around someone who's hurting. And we will want to say a word of welcome to someone who might not feel welcome until we say those words. Extend mercy. And just as important, be ready to receive mercy. For God is merciful. And the church is the avenue that God has chosen for us to show God's mercy. And thanks be to God this day. Amen. Let us all pray. Lord, sometimes life does seem like a party, and we're glad for that. But sometimes life seems like a difficult slog. Help us in both times to be joyful And then when we need to be, help us to be hopeful, hopeful for that day yet to come when all tears will be dried and all mourning will be set aside and we will truly be with you. In the meantime, O God, bless us to live lives which follow in your way of humility and care and compassion. And these things we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Affirmation of faith this day is the Apostles' Creed. It is found printed in our order of service. Together, let us say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And please be seated. Let us pray. Lord, our hope is entirely in you. We know that when we try to go it on our own. The hurts and surprises and twists and turns come too fast for us, and we need you. And so we pray that you'll be especially present to us today and very, very especially present to those who are struggling. Those who are sick or have been sick, we pray the peace of your presence. For those who have suffered the loss of loved ones, we pray that you will assure them of the resurrection. For those who have faced disappointments, we pray your renewal. For those who feel they have failed, we pray that your forgiveness might be real to them. We pray for our world. This world is so beautiful, but it is too often torn by war and disaster. We pray also for our nation and its leaders. Grace us with hope and give our leaders your guidance. We pray for our local community, where the least and the lost are sometimes well known to us. We know them from room in the inn. And we see them on the streets. Make our church, we pray, a place of refuge and healing. We pray for our church. The renewal that we're undergoing seems real, and we pray that new, exciting avenues will continue to open to us. We pray for our church leaders, as those leaders of committees and ministries meet this week to do visioning. Today we want to pray for our friend and colleague, David Muffet. David has given such great service to this church, and he is also a product of this church. And so as he prepares to go to Little Rock, we pray that he will feel the love of this congregation all around him. Make his ministry at the Trinity Presbyterian Church an extension of his life and experience here, and keep us connected by friendship and common ministry through the years to come. As we pray for David and his ministry, and as we pray for our church, we pray for each other, for those seated with us on the right and on the left, so no one will leave here today without having been prayed for. We do that now. Lord, in so many circles, we are counted as the beautiful people, the fortunate ones, the blessed ones. And yet each one of us also has a part in our lives where we are afraid or needy or uncertain. And so we do pray that you will enter the lives of those seated around us, give them and ourselves strength, bless us, and make us a blessing. And hear us now as we pray together the prayer our Lord has taught us all, and we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
The Presbyterian Church's steeple and the church's people have been a blessing to this community for nearly 200 years. The ministry entrusted to us on this corner remains strong. All we have and all we are comes from God. It is our privilege to return a portion of that blessing now. Let us come before God with our tithes and our offerings.
I'd like to ask all of you all to take your hymnals out from underneath the pew in front of you and turn to page 69. We'd like to invite you all to sing with us on the refrain on this. And so Wayne and Ernie asked me, said, we'd like to do one more song with you before you leave. And so you pick one out. And so I picked Here I Am, Lord. And Ernie said, why'd you pick that one? That always makes me cry. And so... But I picked this because it's very personal, and it's God calling us to serve the Lord and serve each other, and our response to that is just beautiful. So it's you listen for God in the night in those quiet moments, and we respond by loving Him and loving each other, and so we respond today in song. So we will try not to get choked up on this one, and we'll get through it. So please join us on the refrain.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my life?
Because we often have only a little to give. Bless us this day to give all that we have, all that we can give. Help us to be generous and humble and to live in this world in ways which become our following you, O Lord, our Christ. And these things we pray in the name of our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
remember the brief reception in our fellowship hall immediately following the service so that we can compare our seersucker, but also give thanks for the ministry among us of David Muffet. And now let us receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and in the life everlasting.